Good morning. Welcome to First Baptist Church. Would you all stand and praise the Lord with us this morning?
Life begins and ends in the dark. Welcome to First Baptist Church. We're so glad that you're here. If this is your first time here, we're especially glad that you would choose to come and worship with us. In the back of your worship guide, bulletin, whatever you call it, is a connect card, and we'd love to just get to know you just a little bit. We have a special gift for you out at the welcome desk. If you'll just take that and give it to Mindy or Andrea, whoever's serving out there today, we'd love to just get to know you a bit and maybe encourage you this week. One of the other things on here is a place for deacon nominations during the month of August. We're taking deacon nominations. You have that opportunity. I hope you've been praying about that. And if you want to do that on the back, place for prayer requests. We take it as an honor and a great responsibility to get to pray with you on your journey. And so I invite you to do that. And you can put those in the offering bowls when they're placed there. Right after the service today, if you're interested in going to Operation Christmas Child Mission Trip, it's just a two-day trip, the Friday and Saturday after Thanksgiving. It's a very attainable deal financially. So if you're interested in that, we're going to have a meeting in the room right outside this door. And so right after the service today, please just come. It won't be about 10 minutes, and just giving you some information and maybe answering any immediate questions you might have. It's a great opportunity, especially if you've never been on a mission trip or you've got life circumstances as I can't take a week off. This is a great opportunity for you to touch the world, to touch the world through missions. We're going to, in fact, during the offering today, we're actually going to get to see a video of highlights of mission trips all the way back from Nicaragua to Boston to Honduras. And so I'm excited about you getting to see that. I've already seen it. So I'm excited about seeing it again. I still haven't figured out if Jerry Miller was getting crushed by that ladder or he was manhandling it. I haven't figured that out from the picture, but I'm going to ask him after the service. Hey, a couple other things. Next Sunday, if you're interested in learning more about First Baptist Church, we're having Discover. We need you to sign up to do that. We provide lunch for you, so it's important that we just know you're coming. And so there's a place in your worship guide to sign up for that if you're interested in learning more about the church. And there's one more thing. I got it. In a week and a half. A week from this Wednesday, we'll kick off our fall semester. And if you're interested in taking one of the studies, they're advertised in here. But you can sign up out in the lobby or email Miss Susan this week at the church, call the church. The most important thing is if you need childcare, that you would sign up for that so we make sure we're prepared for you. Father, thank you for your incredible gifts of love and mercy and grace and salvation. Everything that you give us, God, we are grateful. God, but we're most grateful for a Savior whose name is Jesus. We worship Him today. We exalt Him today. We proclaim Him today. God, would you make yourself strong in this place? We long to hear you speak to us. God, change us for having been here and in your presence today. I pray, God, to be pleased. We want to bless you today with our worship and our response and obedience to you today. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's continue to sing.
You give life, you are love. And all
not someone who came and told us how to live. Someone who came and gave his life so that we could live. We're grateful. Lord, even now as we prepare to give, God, we give out of an act of worship to you, to declare our dependence on you, because we know that everything we have comes from you. It's a gift. And so we give back. God, I pray not only would we be good stewards of what's given, God, I pray we'd be good stewards of what we have left. God, may you find us to be good stewards in the way that we use all of our resources as a church and personally. God, may we give now even to see your kingdom grow, to see the gospel spread across the street and around the planet for the glory of the one who gave all for us, Jesus Christ, I pray. Amen. You can be seated. trapping you, or were you manhandling it? he said they treated you terrible. It really is good to see this morning. I invite you to take a copy of the scriptures and turn to Acts chapter 3. Acts chapter 3, if you don't have a copy of the scriptures with you, it's going to be on the screen. And so you don't need to sweat that. Something I don't talk about very often, but if you need a copy of the scriptures, or you need somebody who doesn't have a copy of the scriptures, we have copies at the welcome desk out there, and we're thrilled to give people copies of the scriptures. So anyway, it's a blessing to give away copies of God's word. I'm grateful for my dear brother Steve Hopkins, who came and preached last week. Pastor Chris and I and Pastor Zach, all three of us trying to squeeze in some vacation, working around school schedules and our family schedules and stuff like that. And so he and I were gone last week. Pastor Zach's gone this week. I had somebody this morning tell me that their kids went back to school and they're worse now than they were when they went to school. So, and then I saw Miss Linda in preschool this morning, and she said, I said, I hear the kids are restless this morning coming off, some of them coming off their first couple of days of school. She said, that's okay, we're talking about the talking donkey this morning, and so it's appropriate. Some of you will get that later. As we continue in this series right now, we're in chapter 3 through 7 of the book of Acts, and we've entitled it First Church. For many of us, if you go to about any town, you're going to see First Baptist Church, First Presbyterian Church, First Methodist Church. Listen, this is the First Church. They're the only ones who really get to claim First Church here in the book of Acts. The first century church had a set of very unique circumstances, and it's a very unique context. Think about it. I mean, the actual apostles who traveled along with Jesus for 3.5 years were still there. Like, it wasn't like they were opening some book and saying, Jesus, it says here in John chapter, what? No, John stood up and said, this is what happened. We get the blessing of the fact that he wrote it down for us, and God inspired that and has preserved that for us. But the first century church actually listened to Peter talk about walking on water and then sinking. I mean, you know, they got to hear him say it. It's a unique thing. And there were thousands of others people who were there when he fed the 5,000. They were there. People who got to touch him. People who were healed by him. People who heard him speak. It's a unique setting. Also, the people who watched him die on the cross. And as the New Testament tells us, over 500 who actually experienced in person the resurrected Christ. It's a unique setting, unique context. Some people have said, you know, we ought to get back to the first century church. We ought to go back to Acts and be just like them. Like most of them were killed because of their faith. Most of them lost their jobs, their incomes because of their faith. Many of them lost their families because of their faith. I'm not really sure any of us, let alone air conditioning and things like that and donkey travel. You know, it's just very different, and I'm not sure, but think about what people lost for their faith. It's a unique context, so I'm not really sure any of us should long to go back to live in the first century church, but they sure have a lot to show us about what it means to passionately follow Christ and to be the church. Acts chapter 2 ends, and there are about 3,000 believers, and we get to see what it looks like for them to live out and engage their faith personally, in the community of believers, and in the community at large. We get to witness that. We get to see what that looks like. And as Acts 3 begins, Peter and John are going to the temple. You're like, well, why did they decide to go to the temple? They didn't decide to go to the temple. They made a decision they were going to go to church, and they went to the temple all the time. It was their normal practice to do that. We see that back in Acts chapter 2. It was the normal practice. People kept going to church. Why did they go to the temple? Was it because that they felt like, well, I got to go there to meet God? No. It was because they wanted to go meet with God with others. That's why we come to church, to encourage each other, to be challenged by each other, to walk with each other. That's why God gave us church. So Peter and John are going to the temple, the normal thing. Imagine John and Peter. They'd seen Jesus feed 5,000. They'd seen him do crowd miracles. They'd seen all that stuff. They personally had been there when Peter preached on the day of Pentecost and 3,000 came to faith. But yet while they're walking into the temple, they still have compassion for one. And this dude is healed. As if you were here last week, he'd been lame since birth. And the people knew him. They knew him. They had walked past him for years. Every day he would come and someone would lay him there on a stretcher at the gate, beautiful, and he would be there to collect alms, and because it was known to be a good thing to give to the poor, and these were the poorest of the poor, and they would come and give money on their way in. And maybe Peter and John had given him money at times on the way in before, but today they look him in the eye and say, I got something better for you. They took time for the one, and as they entered the temple after healing him, he follows them in. And if you happen to grow up in a church like I did as a kid, he was walking and leaping and praising God. I mean, you could sing that all. When I see the picture, that's what I hear in my head. I guess that's better than other things I could be hearing in my head. But, hey, I mean, he's and I can imagine that it was a scene. So I don't know why that Peter and John decide to go out of the worship area and across the court of the Gentiles to where we're going to find them here in verse 11. But the crowd follows, and the guy who was healed follows. And I think what happens next is really critical for us, because what we see is the miracle that God did through them leads to a proclamation, a proclaiming of the gospel. Proclaiming a preaching of the gospel. I believe that God still heals people. Do you? I believe God still does. Three primary ways God heals people. One is by people praying. God answers the prayers of his people and heals people. That's consistent in the New Testament. I believe that God uses doctors and medicine to heal people. That's consistent with the New Testament. And sometimes I believe God uses both. In fact, and many times I think God today uses both. But sometimes what we fail to remember is that physical healing is not God's greatest work. If you go to a small group or you go to a prayer circle or some kind of prayer gathering, and listen to what the majority of prayer requests are, and prayers offered in the room, and their prayers for the physical. And God still does that. But that is not God's greatest work, nor is it God's greatest concern. God always uses, his intent is always to use his working in the physical to lead people to the greatest miracle, his greatest work, which is redemption and salvation in Jesus Christ that gives eternal life, not just extended physical life. So what did that preaching look like? Well, the miracle served to validate and propel forward the proclamation of the gospel, the preaching of the gospel by faith in Christ. So here's what it looks like. Let's read God's word together, starting in verse 11. While he, this is the lame guy who had been healed, who's no longer lame. I shouldn't call him the lame guy. I should call him the jumping up guy, dancing dude. he was holding on to Peter and John, so he just can't let go of them. All the people, utterly astonished, ran toward them in what is called Solomon's Colonnade, or Solomon's Porch. It's on the east wall of the temple across the court of the Gentiles. I find it interesting that he crossed the court of the Gentiles in that area to hang out and talk to the Jewish people, which is really cool. When Peter saw this, he addressed the people, fellow Israelites. So he identifies himself with them, fellow Israelites. Why are you amazed at this? Why do you stare at us as though we had made him walk by our own power or godliness? The God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and denied before Pilate, though he had decided to release him. It sounds like these people are going to get a little confrontation. But he does it in a certainly endearing way, because he introduces this whole deal about you delivered over Jesus with the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And so for a Jewish person, this would be a very, very endearing way for him to introduce this. This is a very secular example, obviously, but he says, if you were in Ohio and you said, all of you fellow Buckeye fans, you're sinners. You know, I mean, okay, I tried to give you something of a little bit of endearment, except for you Michigan fans. Endearing, and then he goes right at them. You handed him over, denied before Pilate, though he had decided to release him. Pilate actually had decided multiple times to release Jesus, and they insisted that he not. Verse 14, you denied the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer released to you. This is really an indictment about to Jewish people. The holy and righteous one, he's talking about their Messiah, and he's putting it right in their face and saying, you did it. The one you say you've been waiting for, you handed him over. You denied him. You killed, verse 15, the source of life. Some of your translations might say the prince of life. This is the author, the authority of life, as Colossians 1 says, that all things were made by him, through him, and for him, Jesus. You killed the source of life, whom God raised from the dead, and we are witnesses of this. Now he's going to explain the miracle, okay? Verse 16, by faith in his name, Jesus, his name has made this man strong, whom you see and know. They're saying, we didn't do this. This was done in the name of Jesus. So the faith that comes through Jesus has given him this perfect health in front of you all. Verse 17, and now, brothers and sisters. So he's not saying, you heathen, hell-bound people. He didn't say that. He said, brothers and sisters, I know that you acted in ignorance, just as your leaders did also. What's that mean? For most people, that would be something of a degrading statement. You acted in ignorance. You were stupid. Listen, he's not saying anything that Jesus didn't say. In fact, Jesus from the cross said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. Why is that important to a Jew? Because if you go back to the law in the Old Testament, if they would have done something like this intentionally with full knowledge of what they were doing, the law would say there's no hope ever for you. And Peter's about to give them hope. He's got to tell him, look, all the bad here, you did it. You had no clue what you were doing. It was bad. You did it. But you acted in ignorance. Verse 18, in this way, God fulfilled what he had predicted through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. This is how God knew you would respond to his Messiah this way, to his son this way, and he predicted it. It was predicted in the prophets. Therefore, verse 19, repent and turn back. Some of your translations might say repent and be converted. When people say, I was converted to Christianity, there was a change. There was a repentance, that's turning from something, turning from your sin, from your way, and being converted or turning to Jesus. That's all it means. significant. So that your sins may be wiped out. That seasons of refreshing may come from the presence of the Lord, and that he may send Jesus, who has been appointed for you as Messiah. Heaven must receive him until the time of the restoration of all things, which God spoke about through his holy prophets from the beginning. Now, this may not make a lot of sense to most of us in 21st century Western culture, but to a Jew, they understood what this meant. They were looking for Jesus the Messiah. They were looking for the Messiah to come and set up his kingdom on the earth. And at the center of that kingdom would be Jerusalem. The Bible teaches that there will come a time, it's called the millennial reign of Christ, a thousand-year reign on the earth, and they were looking for that. And Peter's telling them, Jesus is the key to that. This is why he came. You were looking for that, and if you don't accept him, you'll never see that that you've been looking for. Now he's going to get really serious and go straight to the highest authority that they know in their religion. Verse 22, Moses said, the Lord your God will raise up for you a prophet like me from among your brothers and sisters. You must listen to everything he tells you. And everyone who does not listen to that prophet will be completely cut off from the people. Moses said, he's coming, and you better listen to him when he comes. Peter's saying, he was here. You denied him. You killed him. Verse 24, in addition, all the prophets who have spoken from Samuel and those after him have also foretold of these days. Verse 25, you are the sons of the prophets and the covenant that God made with your ancestors, saying to Abraham, and all the families of the earth will be blessed through your offspring. I want to say two things about that verse. One of the things that is a very popular conversation among the Christian community is this idea of covenant. What does that mean? We see in the Old Testament about covenant. Listen, it's one of the reasons why starting next week, most of our life groups are going to be studying a thing called the Scarlet Thread, and it's a study from Genesis to Revelation, so that you can see how much of this fits in the story of God's redemptive plan. That's why we're doing it. And you'll actually get to study about the covenant and what it means, where it started, what's the deal. What I want you to see at the end of this, it says that all the families of the earth will be blessed through your offspring. Not a Greek scholar, but I do am really interested to know that offspring here, when I read this, I think all the people, all of your kids, all of your descendants, and it's not. The word offspring here is singular, as in one. There's one from the seed of David, from the heritage of Abraham, and he is this Messiah. God raised up, verse 26, his servant, and sent him first to you to bless you by turning each of you from your evil ways. Listen, Peter's contextualizing this gospel message to his Jewish brothers and sisters, to his Jewish family. But let's not be mistaken. The message of the gospel is for everyone. John 3:16 says that for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever would believe in him would not perish but have eternal life. The Apostle Paul said it this way in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel, because it is God's power for salvation to everyone who believes, first to the Jew and then to the Greek. And he's saying there to the Gentile, to the non-Jew. It went to the Jews first. They were God's chosen people through which the Messiah, Jesus, would come. The Savior would come. And he offers it to them first. The message came to them first. And the Bible says that he came to his own, and as a whole, his own didn't receive him. And therefore, the gospel then went to the rest of the world. I want to show you three things from the text about first church, first century preaching that is really, really important. Number one, Peter directs the focus to Jesus. Peter directs the focus to Jesus. He says in verse 16 that the healing of this man came by faith in his, as in Jesus' name. To the people with whom he's speaking, a name means everything. For in that name is your personal. person, your authority, your heritage, your power, your reputation. Everything is held in a name. We have four kids, and I'm not really sure that we gave much credence to what names meant. We just liked names when we named our kids. I don't know about you, but in this day, in the first century, and before that, in a Jewish community, names meant everything. And so when we say, when Peter's saying, you believe in his name, faith in his name, it's about who Jesus is, what he said he did, what he actually did, who he says he was, what he's going to do. It's all about that. It's all encompassed in his name. And then he says the faith to accomplish this miracle was given by and through Jesus. Now, I don't want to get into some deep theological conversation about this today, but here's the reality. The Bible says that it's by grace you are saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It's a gift of God, not of works, lest anyone can boast. Imagine if I'm a businessman, and I'm driving through Lancaster, and I see a building, and I've been thinking about starting a business, and I just happen to drive down a street, and there happens to be a building available that I could use for that business and would be a strategic location. And I didn't make that building there, and I didn't make that building available, but I'm the one who spotted it. I'm the one who went and bought it. I'm the one who put rehab the building. I'm the one who started it. I didn't build the building. But the rest of the success of my business there is on me. And sometimes what happens in Christianity, in this, we try to think, well, Jesus died on the cross, and I happened upon it, and I made a decision that I'm going to do this, and then it's all, you know, I just kind of, I had a huge piece in this. And the reality is that faith in Jesus, look, you got nothing to give him. The Bible says that any kind of righteousness we have looks as like filthy rags compared to his righteousness. And so when God brings us to himself, when he draws us to himself through the Holy Spirit and the Scriptures, when he draws us to himself, he opens our heart to really see the impact of the cross of Jesus Christ. And then when we say, God, I see my desperate need, he then gives us the faith to trust him. Because it's kind of like it says in the New Testament, Lord, I believe, but help my unbelief. I'm not even really sure what I'm believing in. I don't know how to do this. And God gives us the faith to trust him. It's all the work of God in our lives. It's about us understanding how much we need him. And then God so desperately wants a relationship with us, he shows us how to trust him. And here, Peter is saying, there was faith exhibited in Jesus' name, and Jesus even gave him the faith to do it. I mean, how did this guy know? They say, silver and gold have I none, but what I give you, I give in the name of the Lord Jesus. How do you know he even knew who Jesus was? God is so good. He puts the focus on Jesus. The result of the miracle is to bring attention publicly and undeniably to Jesus. The whole miracle was done to bring attention and a conversation about Jesus. We must direct the focus of physical life to Jesus and then turn that conversation to the eternal life in Jesus. Listen, you and I, we get to see God's creation all around us. God didn't make his creation just so that we could say, wow, he gave us his creation so that it could spark a conversation about his goodness and his greatness. God works in your life and my life so that we could give praise to Jesus. And praise to Jesus means that we talk about him. And it always leads to something better. Listen, Lisa and I just went to the Grand Canyon back in May. First time we'd ever seen it. It was inspiring to think God did that. Canyon is maybe considered one of the seven wonders of the world. But every one of you in this room who has been changed and forgiven of your sin and changed by the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ is so much greater a miracle than that. Because God could speak and the Grand Canyon goes. But in order to do the miracle in your life and my life, he sent his son to die on a cross. Greatest miracle. And God does miracles so that we can direct the attention to Jesus. And when we direct the attention to Jesus in the physical, it should help us direct the attention to Jesus for the eternal. Second, not only direct the focus to Jesus, but declare our sinfulness. Boy, we do not like this conversation. We don't. We don't like this conversation. We live in a world that wants to say, you're okay, I'm okay, we're all okay. Or even if we're not okay, we're not as bad as somebody else. But the reality of the scripture says that in our sin, we are enemies of God. That doesn't play real well out in the public. It doesn't play real well in politics. It doesn't play real well around the water cooler at work or in the locker room at school. We like comparing our sinfulness to the sinfulness of others. But compared to the holiness and the righteousness of God, our sin is ugly and filthy and separating us from God. And Peter goes there. He gives a corporate indictment. He says, you handed him over to Pilate, even though Pilate tried to let him go. You denied the holy, righteous one. You denied your own Messiah. You did it. You killed him. You killed the source of life. The one who gives you life, the one who created you, you killed him. And they're all saying, I'm sure. No, the Romans did that. No. You did that. Reality is, based on the authority of God's word, we did that. You did that. I did that. But in ignorance, have a clue what we were doing. They didn't have a clue what they were doing. Their sin, they sinned. It was horrible. And then he turns to the prophetic conviction. Say, hey, you know, this isn't something new. God knew this was going to happen. God prepared this, his son, to come all the way back, even in the prophets. He knew it was going to happen. Listen to Isaiah chapter 53. He grew up before him like a young plant. Like a root out of dry ground, he didn't have an impressive form or majesty that we should look at him, no appearance that we should desire him. But he was despised and rejected by men. He, a man of suffering who knew what sickness was. He was like someone people turned away from. He was despised and we didn't value him. Yet he himself bore our sickness. He carried our pain. We regarded him as stricken, struck down by God and afflicted. They thought what they were doing was righteous before God, and it was just the opposite. They were denying God's plan of redemption. But he was pierced because of our rebellion. He was crushed because of our iniquities. Punished for our peace. Punishment for our peace was upon him, and we are healed by his wounds. Because we all went astray like sheep. We all turned to our own way, and the Lord punished him for the iniquity, the sin of us all. Hundreds of years before, God sent prophets to say it's going to happen. So when it would happen, when it did happen, Peter could look at these Jewish people and say, look, you acted out of ignorance. God tried to tell you it was going to happen. Will you listen now? Will you listen now? He declared their sinfulness. He declared personal responsibility as well. For even though he's declaring, you all did this, you all did that, you denied, you killed, you turned over, all that stuff, what does he say? What does he say down here in verse 19? Therefore, repent, and turn back. Turn away from this, your path. Turn back to God. Turn back to the way it was supposed to be. Turn to Jesus. Personal responsibility. You know how Jesus said that? You know, John 3:16, we talked about. John 3:17, for God didn't send his son into the world to condemn the world, but the world through him might be saved. He's still talking about the world. But then what does he do in verse 18? He says, if you believe in him, you are not condemned. But if you don't believe in him, you are condemned already because you've not believed in the name, the only Son of God. The whole world has a sin problem. It's common. And Peter identifies with it. It's our problem. But no one can declare on behalf of the world repentance and faith. That comes from individuals. That's why we talk about the fact that God's looking for a relationship with you. Your response, this problem of sin is common to everyone. And you can't avoid it because it's in you. But the response can't be from a family's response or a nation's response. It comes from individual people who believe in the name of Jesus Christ. For there is salvation in no other. No other name given under heaven by which people can be saved but the name of Jesus. What does that look like as parents? I read a Facebook post from a social media post from a friend of mine talking about an experience that she had at Target with a parent who would not do anything with their child, who was throwing a tantrum, and then the parent ended up throwing a tantrum on the child. I think it's really about us as parents being bigger than that and not throwing tantrums. Imagine if God threw a tantrum every time you did. Aren't you glad God doesn't throw tantrums when we do? Then I thought, as parents, what do we do? We're supposed to model, as imperfectly as we do it, we're supposed to model what the Heavenly Father and the gospel are like to our kids. That means that we have guidelines for them. You live in my house, you live by these rules, and we try to make those rules honor God. You break the rules, there are consequences to those rules. And then, with love and grace, we try to restore after those consequences. We all have a problem. Our problem is sin. God made a way through Jesus to deal with the consequences of that sin, which is death and hell and judgment. God made a way to deal with that that exhibits his grace and love to us. With me? And when we as parents don't model that for our children, what we do is we tell them that sin's not that big a problem. Sin's a big problem. It is an eternal life-altering problem. And Peter declares our sinfulness. There can be no salvation without conviction first. There is no hope of eternal life needed unless there is hopelessness in our sin. If we're not hopeless in our sin, why do we need Jesus? If there's some other way, why do we need him? We are hopeless in our sin. But then Peter gives them hope. He gives them hope. He says in verse 19, therefore repent and turn back or be converted so that your sins may be wiped out. The words there for wiped out mean like it was written on a page in permanent ink and he comes along with his hand and wipes it clean. Wipes it clean. There's a picture of that in Colossians 2:14 when the Apostle Paul says that Jesus has taken the declaration, the writ, W-R-I-T, the declaration of our sin, and he's taken that and he's put it totally away, wiped it totally clean. How? Did he just go, they're okay, I think I'll just... No, he doesn't do that. He doesn't take it over here and stick it in a fire and burn it. Colossians 2:14 says he took it and he nailed it to his cross. The wiping out, the cleaning of our sin slate cost that much that he would nail it to his cross. But he wipes it out totally. As the psalmist wrote in Psalm 120 or 103:12, he said, he takes our sin and he separates it from us as far as the east is from the west. He throws it into the deepest sea and he remembers it no more. People around you, your family, the people you sinned against, the people you may have hurt, they may not forget it. We sometimes can't forget our own sin, but Jesus does not remember your sin. It's gone. And he brings spiritual refreshment. Jesus himself talked about this in John 4:14, where he tells the woman at the well, he said, those who drink of the water that I give will never thirst again. Not only that, but there will be wells of living, fresh springs of water rising up inside. Refreshment. He gave us his spirit himself to live inside of us. And then it says that there would be physical and universal restoration this millennium. You know, it may be something that we struggle to deal with. These people knew what he was talking about. They'd been talking about it for centuries. So when he brings it up, they know what he's talking about. But there is going to come a time when on this earth, God is going to set up his kingdom. And all of that that happened back in Genesis chapter 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, when earth being perfect because of the sin of man was made to be imperfect and be a place of toil and thorns. Imagine rose bushes with no thorns. Imagine perfect amount of rain. Imagine what it would be like. Imagine when all the animals got along. Imagine when all the people got along. Romans chapter 8, verse 18 through 37. The Apostle Paul's talking about the groaning of creation, longing for the day when things are made right. And the message of the gospel is telling, not only are your personal sins wiped out, not only will I be with you, will God be with you, will God give you refreshing times of abundant life, but there's coming a time when you will suffer. There will be no more suffering at all. That's the hope of the gospel. I want you to imagine with me, if you would, for just a moment. If on the video screen, for the next however long it would take, there would be a documentary video of all the sin you have ever committed or ever will commit. Not just the things you did, but the things you thought. Can you imagine the fear, the guilt, the shame? I asked that question of myself out Thursday and thinking what that would look like and how I would be feeling. But I want you to imagine that in the midst of the deepest, darkest fear and shame and guilt, somebody walked through that door and walked up here. And with a hand that had a nail scar in it, went like, and it was all gone. Peter's teaching and the gospel teaches that when you come to faith in Christ, when you genuinely repent of your sin and you place your faith in Jesus, that God looks at you with the righteousness of his Son, not in your sin. He wipes it out. And as Tony Marita reminded me this week from Revelation 21:4, as sure as Jesus wipes away our sin, the moment we ask him to do it, he will one day wipe away every tear from our eye. There will be no more death, no more suffering, no more pain, no more broken relationships, no more heartache. The same God who wipes away our slate of sin will one day make everything right. Proclaiming the gospel hope in Jesus Christ always comes with a critical question. Peter asked the question in a declarative way because he was really serious about it. See, if it were me, I'd probably ask the people, would you like to repent of your sin and turn to Jesus? Peter was a bit more serious and forward with it. Repent! Turn to Jesus. Repent. Turn to Jesus. Repent. Turn to Jesus. And he couldn't do it for them. But he was so passionate about it. That's the question. If you're here this morning and you're not a follower of Christ, Jesus is it. And it's the goal of our church to direct everything to Jesus. He is the only one who is hope. Our sin problem, my sin problem, has been dealt with on the cross. And by faith, though I'm not perfect now, he sees me through the blood of his Son. Not because of anything I've ever done, but because of the blood of Jesus and my faith that I've placed in him that he gave me. Listen, you have a sin problem. Separates you from God, and Jesus is your only hope. But there is hope in Jesus, and you can trust him. Would you place your faith in him today? Repentance and faith are not optional responses to the gospel. It's the only appropriate response is repentance and faith. If you're here this morning and you're a believer, I would ask you this: how does God want to take your conversations and turn them to focus on Jesus? How does he want to do that? Would you let him do that? Would you ask him to help you do that? To turn your focus of your conversations on Jesus? What has God been doing in your life that he wants to be used to turn people's attention to Jesus so that he can turn their attention to eternal life and salvation in him? What's God been doing in your life that he does not want you to passively talk about, but he wants you to praise him and give him glory by turning the attention to Jesus and the salvation that comes only through him? That comes through gratefulness for what he's done and surrender of your life to say, God, I want you to not only take my life, but my life includes my conversations. God, will you take my conversations and point them to Jesus? And would you use the incredible things you're doing in my life to point people to the gospel so that they can experience not good stuff, but the one who brings redemption? So I think that's true. Our greatest worship of God is not praising him for the stuff he does, but for the redemption he's brought through his only Son, Jesus Christ. That's the greatest praise we give him when we praise him for the redemption that he's brought. Chris Tomlin has a song written by Andrew Peters. year since it's out, and it's been out for about a year, and it's become very popular. I must say I've probably watched videos of it. I watched a couple live performances. I just happened to be everywhere I was this week, and just really drew my attention. He asked the question, is he worthy? Is he worthy? Is Jesus worthy of your life, my life? Is he? Is he worthy of your life? He gave his own life for you. Oh, he is so worthy. The answer yesterday in the first century and today and tomorrow will forever be Jesus is worthy. I'm going to pray, and we're going to sing about the worthiness of Jesus. And for some of you, if you're not yet a follower of Christ, today is your day. Today's the day that you're going to play. You want to, and Jesus said, whoever will may come. It's your day. Place your faith in Jesus today. If you want someone to pray with you, I'm going to be here while we sing to do that. If you're here as a follower of Christ and God's been speaking to you, would you allow him to not only be Lord of your salvation, but Lord of your life, which means Lord of your conversations, that he would turn your conversations to direct them to Jesus, which then propels the story of your life to propel the gospel to people who need the greatest work that he can do, and that's eternal life and salvation. Father, thank you for the gift of your word. Thank you for the gift of Peter's sermon that we could hear, and that God, we can learn from that. God, would you help us direct the attention to Jesus? Would you help us not avoid the problem of sin? God, thank you for dealing with our sin in the cross and the hope of the gospel that is in Christ. And I look forward to the day. God, we look forward to the day when we worship him. We worship him. We bow at his feet. God, we bow at his feet today because he is worthy. God, change us for having been in your presence right now. For the glory of Jesus, I pray. Amen. Won't you stand? place today, I pray that Jesus will be enough. You said he was enough for our sin and debt. And you said he would be enough for everyday life. Or with the Apostle Paul, we declare that my God shall supply all of your needs according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. In Jesus. So, Lord, I pray you draw us to yourself, and that would propel us speaking about you, as the Apostle Peter would say. How can we help but speak about what we've seen and witnessed and experienced? God, that the gospel would be sweet on our lips, and that Jesus Christ would be so precious in our hearts, that it would change the way we live. God, continue to draw people to yourself for the glory of the one who came.